We're going to start with a song called Here For You, which is a declaration, I think, of why we're here. We are here for God, we are here for Jesus, and this is a song of worship to reflect that fact. So, Here For You.
Welcome in this place. We welcome you with praise. Praise the name. Good morning and welcome to worship. That was a great way to start the day. Thank you. A message from Fliss to say that Meet the Neighbours Coffee Morning is starting up again. It's going to switch from Tuesdays to Thursdays, and the first time they're going to meet is Thursday the 21st of October. So do come along for coffee, tea and cake. And talking of coffee, we have nobody on the coffee rota for today. So if anybody's, it's all set up, ready to go. If we have got two volunteers that could do that at the last minute, that would be great, and the rota is looking fairly blank for the next few weeks, so if we could try and fill that up, that would be great. Just leaves me to welcome David. May God bless you, David, as you lead us in worship.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. It's good to be here together. We're going to stand if you're able and invite you to stand now. Let's just center ourselves before God. And we declare in his name that we are his people. He is our God. We're here to worship, to praise him, to celebrate the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, our God, we lay our lives before you. We cast our crowns before you, those things which we count as our riches, we cast them down before you because all belongs to you. And we know that you are here in this place, that you are with us each and every moment of every day. So all praise, all glory and honor be unto you, Almighty God.
Thank you.
sometimes we have no idea where that's going. But it's okay, because he's the one who calls us on. And so if you're longing to follow, if you're wondering where that path's going to lead you, then simply say that Jesus is enough for me. That in this place, as we gather in your name, we can lift our voices in song, in praise and worship of you. Help us to also listen, to hear you speak to us. to speak to us about those things which are a storm in our life, which are a trouble to us, which are the mountains which seem to want to overpower us. And you speak your word of command. You call to the storm to be still. You speak your word and the mountain moves. You bring light into the darkness. You open our eyes to see you. You open your arms to receive us in. You brought your Son to us, who gave his life so that we might live. And so, Lord, we bring to you ourselves, we bring to you our hopes, our fears, and we lay all before you, because you are the God who provides, you are the God who heals, you are the God who restores. And in Jesus Christ, you are the God who saves.
Bless the Savior, thou hast born.
So, Lord God, we ask you to send your Holy Spirit once more upon us. Come and fill this place. Come and fill each one of us to overflowing with a new measure of love, a new measure of faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Right. Yes, that was good, wasn't it? An extra verse. You can always do with an extra verse on a good hymn like that, can't you? This morning, we are looking at a passage of scripture from Hebrews. And Hebrews is a great book in the Bible. If you've never read Hebrews before, go and have a look at it. It is one of those books where it's such rich in its theology, in the sense of, oh wow, just think about the consequences of what is just said there. It talks about the supremacy of Christ and how he is above all others. You know, it says, like, if you think Moses is good, have a look at Jesus. You know, if you think Aaron was amazing, have a look at Jesus. Whatever's come before, whatever will come afterwards, just have a look at Jesus. And it takes us through step by step, very easily, this understanding of Jesus is above all others. So we're going to be looking at that a little bit this morning. And who's reading for us this morning? Nikki, it's excellent. So Nikki's going to read for us, firstly, a few verses from chapter 1, and then a few verses from chapter 2. Thank you, Nikki. You got a mic? Do you want to come with us?
Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, and Hebrews chapter 2, verses 5 to 12. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets as many times and in various ways. But in these days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through him also he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. It is not to angels that he has subjected the world to come, about which we are speaking, but there is a place where someone has testified. What is mankind that you are mindful of them, a son of man that you care for him? You made them a little lower than the angels. You crowned them with glory and honor and put everything under his feet. In putting everything under them, God left nothing that is not subject to them. Yet at present, we do not see everything subject to them. But we do see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a little while, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. In bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. Both the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters. He says, I will declare your name to my brothers and sisters. In the assembly, I will sing your praises. Thank you.
Thank you. How many of you have ever been told you look just like, and it's usually your mother or your father, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. I was always told, oh, you look just like your dad. And you know, sometimes that's a good thing, and sometimes it's not, doesn't it? It depends on how you're feeling at the time and how well your mum or dad looks as well at the time. You know? But actually, there is something really striking in that, isn't there? You know, people do look incredibly like, very often, another member of their family. And it's not always like your mum or your dad, it could be an auntie or an uncle or something like that. And my mum always used to say I look just like my granddad, her dad, who died before I was born. So I never met him, I never knew him at all, but she reckoned I was just like him in so many ways. And the writer to the Hebrews is trying to help us understand something about God, trying to open our eyes to see who God is. And that's difficult, isn't it? Let's be honest, you know, it's not easy to see who God is if you're starting from scratch, shall we say. How do you picture God? How do you to get to understand God? And so the writer to the Hebrews is saying, listen, God has always wanted to make himself known. God has been doing this since the year dot. He's been making himself known in many and various ways. He uses this phrase, many and various ways. God has made himself known. And if you think about the Old Testament, you'll soon think, oh yeah, well of course there's the prophets. God made himself known through the prophets. Or there's angels who suddenly turn up in various places. Or somebody comes and wrestles with somebody else and God makes himself known in those sorts of episodes. And of course then you look at things like the Exodus. God makes himself known spectacularly in those sorts of ways, doesn't he? God has always been making himself known if you care to look, if you care to see, if you care to understand. But he's saying, the writer to the Hebrews, we don't know who it is, by the way. We don't know who it was written to, what it was for, who it's by or when it was written. Don't know anything like that about it. We can have a few guesses, but essentially, we don't know. And in some ways, that's quite good because it strips away the sort of like, oh, well, it was set in this context, so it's set in that context. Let's just listen to it today and see what it's really saying to us today. And so this writer to the Hebrews is wanting us to say that if you want to see God, you only have to look at the Son, Jesus. You only need to do that one simple thing. Look at Jesus and you'll see God. Because he is this, he's the reflection of God's glory, the exact imprint of God's very being. And he uses this phrase which has an echo of when a coin is made. You have this, you know, if you take a coin out of your pocket now, you'll see an impression of somebody on it, the Queen. And depending on when it was made, it was a fairly good likeness of her at that time. If it's a very old coin, it probably doesn't look anything like her now. But the later coins will look just like she does now. It's a very clear representation, and every single one is exactly the same because they're all stamped exactly the same. And the writer to Hebrews is saying, you know, it's a bit like that when you look at Jesus. It's an exact stamp of God. It's not an approximation. It's not a rough image or anything like that. One of the things that these verses say to us is that God wants to be known. There's all sorts of mystery about God, and I think mystery is good, actually. I think we put too much weight on we have to know absolutely everything. Sometimes mystery is good. We're going to be celebrating a great mystery later on when we celebrate Holy Communion. The bread and the wine, the body and blood for us as Christ. There is deep mystery in that. You can't fully explain it. You can't fully understand it, but as you feed upon it in your heart, you understand the sacrifice of Christ for you. And there is something very mysterious in that, and all the richer for it. If you understood it perfectly, well, would there actually be any need to come to the table? I'll leave that one with you to ponder on, because I haven't got an answer myself. But you ponder on it, okay? Don't be afraid of the mystery. God reveals to us the things that we need to know today. And the things that we don't need to know today, we don't need to worry about. And if he reveals them to us tomorrow, then he reveals them to us tomorrow. God, though, does want to be known. And as I've said, throughout the whole history of the Bible, we see this time after time. There's a bush burning over there, and Moses is drawn to it. And in it, he has this revelation of God. God wants to be known. I've not watched Crime Watch for a long time. Is it still on telly, Crime Watch? It is, okay. But one thing I always remember at Crime Watch is when they used to have these sketches of the criminals they were looking for. And you'd look at these sketches, you think, is that actually a human being, that sketch? You know, I've never seen anybody who looks vaguely like that. And they're these odd photo fits where they take, like, a bit of the forehead, a bit of the eyes, a bit of the nose, and they put it together, it looks like Frankenstein's monster, doesn't it? You know, it's a very rough approximation. But then you see, like in another show later on, when they've caught that person, and they show you an actual picture of them, you say, oh yeah, he does look a bit like that, doesn't he? And those ways in which God has shown himself prior to Jesus is a bit like one of those photo fits, a bit like a sketch and a rough approximation. Have a look at this and you'll get an idea of who God is, but you don't get the whole picture. And then comes Jesus and you get the whole picture because, as the writer says, he is the reflection of God's glory, the exact imprint of God's very being. You don't have to guess anymore at what God looks like. We started singing this morning, well, at 10:30 we started singing, Your Love is Amazing. How do we know that God's love is amazing? That's not a rhetorical question, that's one that requires an answer. How do we know that God's love is amazing? Thank you. He gave Jesus for us. Every time we look at the cross, we know that God's love is amazing. In fact, amazing really doesn't cut it, does it? It's not a good enough word for how amazing God's love is. That God should give his only son, Jesus, so that whoever believes in him may have that eternal life, may know that love is for them. That is beyond amazing, isn't it? But that's all we've got. That's all I've got to say, because I'm not skillful enough to say anything better than that. And so we sing it for all our worth. Your love is amazing. Hallelujah. When we sing hallelujah in any context, we really ought to be shouting it as loudly as we possibly can. It's not a mousy sort of word, hallelujah. It's a lion roaring sort of word. Okay, so if it comes up in any of the songs between now and the end of the service, I expect to hear a roar of hallelujahs, okay? I can't think whether it does or not, so we'll find out, all right? And so these prophets and other ways that God showed us who he was, they weren't the full picture. They're a bit of a sketch, an outline, and then comes Jesus. Jesus is this true image. He's the exact representation of the Father. And there's this invitation that runs throughout the whole of Hebrews, throughout the whole of Scripture, in fact, but certainly in Hebrews. There's this invitation in this letter to come and know this God through the Son, Jesus. Come and get to know him for yourself. Don't be left outside looking in. You don't have to be disregarded. You don't have to be left to your own devices. You don't have to be left, you know, in the gutter or wherever you're floundering. But actually, the writer says, you'll be crowned with glory and honor because of the Son when you become known by God and known of God. And this is the whole, this is one of the things about seeing who Jesus is. You don't only get to know God, you become known as well. Now, obviously God knows who you are whether you know Jesus or not. But there's that deeply personal knowing one of the other as you enter deeper into this relationship with Jesus. It's a bit like your next door neighbor. You know, the one who you see who you don't really talk to. You know who they are, don't you? Because you see them. But when you start inviting them into your house for a cup of tea, you not only know them, you become known as well, don't you? And it's that mutual thing. And the writer to the Hebrews is saying, you don't need to stay distant from God. And God certainly doesn't want to stay distant from you. He wants you to know him so that you can be fully known by him as well. In that deep, deep relationship. That place where you don't just call out to God, you call Father. And this writer to the Hebrews is saying, don't stay outside. Come in. Come in to that place of knowing and being known. See, this is what God longs for each of us. And most of us here this morning, I guess, and those watching at home, welcome, those of you at home. But those of us who are gathered here, I guess most of us know that already. That God longs for each of us to understand and to know that deep love that he has for us that is represented in the Christ, in the cross of Christ. But he also wants us to not just stop there. Because there are many people, might be your next door neighbor, might be a member of your family, it might be somebody who you just bump into and you never ever see them again, but he wants them to know about this Son as well. He wants them to see him through his Son Jesus. And how do people see Jesus? They see him in you. And so we become part of that reflected glory. We won't be as a perfect imprint as Jesus is, obviously. But we can try, can't we? Let me say that again. Is this working? Yeah, we can try, can't we?
Yes.
Thank you. Just checking you're awake. Okay. This is what God longs for each of us, this knowledge and understanding of the depth of his love. And that's why he sent Jesus. And that's why he sends us with the power of the Holy Spirit to make his name known. And so Hebrews takes us through this amazing journey of understanding about just who Jesus is. And he explains that there really is no one like him at all. And this is the beauty about knowing Jesus. This is the beauty about the Christian faith. There is nothing that matches up to it. There is no other way to come and know the beauty, the majesty, the love, the grace, the peace, the truth that is in God. He's supreme. Jesus is supreme in all respects. So ask yourself this morning, do you need a teacher? Do you need somebody to explain things to you? Well, Jesus is the one in whom all truth resides. If you're looking for truth, look to him. Do you need a guide? Are you Are you lost? Are you floundering? Are you stumbling around in the dark? Well, he is the one who goes before us. He is the one who shines that light for our feet through his word. He is the one who leads us onwards. Do you need a healer this morning? Well, he's the one who brought all things into being. He's the one who is the creator of life. He is the one who breathes life. You can't get a better healer than that. Bring to him your body, your mind, your spirit for healing. And ultimately, do you need saving? Well, he's the Redeemer. And he is the one who has dealt with sins fully and finally. And hear those last two words. Well, it's three actually. Fully and finally. But the fully and finally bit, I mean. Jesus has dealt with your sins fully and finally. And do you know what that means? That means that you are free, that you are no longer a slave to sin, or as we might sing, no longer a slave to fear, because Jesus has dealt with your sins fully and finally. And that means there is nothing left out. That thing that you think you cannot be forgiven for, you already have been, as you've confessed it to him. That thing that you will do tomorrow that you will regret after having done it is already covered by that fully and finally. There is nothing that the grace of God through Jesus Christ does not cover as we lay it down before him. No guilt, no shame, no fear, no doubt. Fully and finally, hear that this morning. I don't know who I'm speaking to here, but whoever you are, hear that very clearly this morning. Your sins are covered fully and finally. And so let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that we can see Jesus, our friend, our teacher, our healer, our savior, our guide. And as we see Jesus, as we speak with him, as we walk with him, as we listen to him, we see you, our Father, revealed to us. We praise you that in Jesus Christ we have life, that fullness of life, that life set free from the power of sin and death. And so we rejoice in that. We shout hallelujah. We praise your holy name. And in the name of Jesus we pray, now and always. Amen. So normally I ask you, where have you noticed God this week? I'm going to ask you the same question, but maybe change it slightly. Where have you noticed Jesus this week? Because if we notice Jesus, then we notice God as well, don't we? Okay. Where have you noticed God? Where have you noticed Jesus this week? Where have you felt his touch upon your life? Where have you heard him speaking to you quietly in the night or wherever it might be? Where have you noticed God this week? Come and share with us.
This isn't probably sort of quite what you're after, but anyway. We were lucky enough to go away for a few days this week, and just looking, it was down by the coast, and just looking at the tide coming in. The tide comes in twice a day, most places. And you're on the beach, and people around, there's been maybe not so many children at the moment, there's been dogs and people walking around, and the beach and the sand just gets, it gets trampled on, and it gets messed around, and the tide comes in, and it just washes all that away, and that's just the same as God with our sins, just washes it all away. So.
That's exactly what I was looking for, Nate. Thank you, yes, yeah. Stewards, next time we have an LA, I think Nick's got a word to share with us. Yeah, excellent. Thank you. Anybody else? Yeah, thank you. Yes,
this has just been a couple of things in the coffee shop this week where God has really prompted us to pray for people and speak to people. And I don't know whether it's partly this God in our lives thing that you're thinking, actually, if I go and speak to that person, I might have somebody to talk about in the service. But on Monday, me and Ali were working, and it was unusually quiet. And there were a couple of ladies that came in we hadn't seen before, and I don't think they'd been in before. But they just got chatting, and they said, this is obviously a Christian kind of place. So we talked to them and said, yes, it was, and how it come about, and that was that. We had a little chat with them, told us their names, and then we had a few other customers to serve, and then it went quiet again, and they said, actually, I've got something to ask you. You can say no, but would you be able to come and pray with us? So of course we didn't say no. So we went over and prayed with these two ladies. One had a back problem, and we just sat and prayed with them, and it was just a really lovely spirit-filled time, really. And she said she felt the Holy Spirit, that she hadn't felt that in a long time. So that was really lovely. So yeah, just things like that. And then there was another lady who was in, who was clearly a lonely lady, so just prompted us to go over and chat to her. So God is always there, isn't he? So prompting us to do things and speak to people and tell them of his love for us.
Excellent. Thank you. Well done. Any more? Okay, thank you for sharing those. It's always good to hear these stories. It gives us a glimpse, again, of what God is doing, who he is. A couple of things to share with you about things that are going to be happening over the next few weeks and months. If you remember last Easter, we celebrated Holy Communion in the car park, and it was brilliant, really thoroughly enjoyed it, and it's been on my mind to do that regularly, and I'm going to start doing it on Saturday mornings. At the moment I'm looking at the third Saturday of the month, which is this Saturday, pardon? No, that's on the 4th. Yeah, I've checked that. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, so it's going to be on the third Saturday of the month, which is this Saturday. At the moment, myself and Anna are going to be here. Probably like between 10 and 11. We'll see how the time goes. It might be a bit longer than that. But it's that sort of thing. And if you'd like to come and receive communion at that point, if you happen to be in the village, do stop and receive communion, come and share together. But the idea is that we're going to be wanting to allow people to see Jesus in that place. Okay, so we're going to be doing that, and if there's the opportunity to pray with people, we'll be doing that as well. So please do pray for that. That's going to be really important. The other thing is, going to be starting an Alpha course in a few weeks' time in the meeting place on Wednesday nights. Really want this to be a place of where people who have not necessarily encountered Jesus before get the opportunity to encounter him. So if you know somebody who is either has a few searching thoughts about faith, and they're not quite sure, or they're a real skeptic or whatever, then invite them to come. Even if they say no, it doesn't matter, just invite them to come, okay? And what I don't want to do is fill the Alpha course with lots of people who already know Jesus, all right? That's not the purpose of it. We've got Bible studies for those sorts of folks. But if you know somebody, your next-door neighbor, a family member, whoever it might be, who you think, actually, it would be really great for them to come and explore faith, this is a great vehicle to do it, you can bring them. You're allowed to come as well, okay? So there's an incentive. If you want to come, find somebody to bring with you who doesn't know Jesus yet. Pray for the Alpha course. Pray for the people who will be invited. You don't need to know who they are. Just pray for them that God will give them a real nudge to get them there. And then the last thing to share with you this morning is, many of you will be aware that at the Methodist conference this last summer, the conference passed the resolutions regarding the marriage and relationships report. Principal amongst that is that they made it possible to have same-sex marriages within Methodist premises. The decision needs to be made by the church council as to whether any particular church is willing to allow that or not. And so the church council are going to be making that decision in November. Prior to that, however, we want to give the membership of the church, those of you who worship here regularly, the opportunity to share your own views. This isn't going to be a debate. We're not going to be arguing about things. We're simply going to listen to one another in love. And if you disagree with somebody, you need to love them a bit more. Okay? And that's all there is to it. We're just going to listen to one another so that we have an understanding of how we feel as a church, where we feel we are as a church. And then the church council will make the decision, because that's what you've elected them to do, about whether we should allow that or not within this church. That will be on this. That open meeting will be on the afternoon of Sunday, the 7th of November, at 3:00. I don't know how long it will be. How long it will last? It depends on how many people wish to speak. If you wish to speak, I suggest you prepare yourself beforehand, and you will have a maximum of 3 minutes. Okay, that's to stop anybody going on and on and on. All right. If you want to speak for less than 3 minutes, that's fine, okay? And it will be a very straightforward thing where you will be listened to, and your views will be valued, and you will be loved. Prior to that, on Monday, the 1st of November, here, probably at 7:30, Ian is going to do a brief overview of how the Methodist Church has come to this point, and the sort of like main issues and the scriptural basis behind it, I think is a fair summation of what you're going to do. So if you're not sure of what to think and you want a bit of guidance on how to formulate your views, then come and see what Ian has to share on that Monday, the 1st of November, 7:30 here. And then Sunday, the 7th of November, 3:00, here again, we'll have that open meeting for people to share their views one with each other. And then the church council will meet the following week and make the decision. Okay? And that's all I have to say on that. So let's... we don't need to take up the offertory because the box is out in the entrance there. And let's just give thanks to God for all that he's given to us. Lord our God, we are thankful for the many blessings that you pour into our life day by day. Things that you place into our hands, the gifts, the skills that we have, we offer them to you. We offer to you also our gifts of money. I pray that they would be used in this church, in the name of Jesus, so that his love and name may be known by and many in this place. And it is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. We join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And so as we prepare to gather around the Lord's table, we're going to sing again, and the harbour will come and join us as well, and then we shall share in the bread and wine together.
Power of prayer.
So I need somebody to tell me, what have you got on your heads? These are amazing. What are they about? What are your ears about? Can you remember? Who has ears to hear? Let him listen. Fantastic. You've taken yours off, have you? Well, don't you? Oh, no. But you spent all that time making them. And Ava's got some, and Anna's got some as well. Fantastic. Ian will be delighted with that. And Julie's got some as well. Fantastic. Pardon? Pardon? Okay, wonderful. Well, that's wonderful. So who are you listening to with your ears? What was that about, do you think? Who are you listening to? Is it Mummy, do you think? Is it Mummy, do you think? Who do you say you're listening to? Who is it, Ava? Who is it? You're listening to? Jesus. Listening to God. Excellent. Wonderful. Usually, if the answer isn't Jesus, it's God. And if it's not God, it's usually Jesus. Okay, so if you're stuck, just say God or Jesus, and you're usually right. Wonderful. That's brilliant. Well, we're going to listen about the love of Jesus for us. And sometimes you listen to things that aren't necessarily words. Sometimes you can listen in your heart. Listen to what's going on inside you. And as we eat this bread and we drink this wine, we listen again to God's love for us. We listen and we remember that God sent Jesus to us. He sent him to us when we were lost. He sent him to us when we were afraid. He sent him to us when we were in trouble. And he died for us upon the cross. And in that death, he broke for us the power of sin and death, so that we might live free in that life that Jesus has given to us. And so we remember our Savior Jesus. On the night in which he was betrayed, at supper with his disciples, he took bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said, "Take this and eat it, all of you. This is my body, which is given for you." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, blessing it, he said, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is given for you, which is shed for you, for all people." And so we today eat this bread and we drink this wine to remember our Savior Jesus, to listen to him in our hearts, saying, "I love you. Gave my life for you." So we do this in remembrance of him. We pray, Heavenly Father, send down your Holy Spirit so that this bread and this wine might become for us the body and blood of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we receive the bread and the wine this morning, you'll be invited to come forward. We're going to file past the front, taking the bread here, the wine here, and you can put your glasses on the table there. In the center aisles, just simply loop round in your one row. On the ends, if you go through the doors and come back so that you're not bumping into each other and not going backwards across the front of the church, across the line who's already coming forward. So when you're ready, when the community stewards invite you to come, do come. All is ready. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you have fed us in this place. You've fed our hearts, you've fed our souls, you've fed our minds. And as we have eaten of this bread of heaven, and drunk from this cup of salvation, may we be strengthened for the work that you call us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Are you ready to sing, Evie? Sounds like you are. Let's close by singing a song
that tells us about how we're guided and led every day in our life by Jesus. Let's stand together. And don't forget, if the word hallelujah appears in this song, I expect to hear it shouted out really loud, okay?
Thank you.
the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.